And welcome back, everybody. You're watching News Channel 3 Live at 9 in an economy where layoffs and buyouts are becoming more and more common these days, and people are suddenly losing their jobs. A lot of folks, of course, are looking for work.
Indeed. So we have called Terry Murphy back into the studio. She, of course, is founder of Women's Wisdom Network. And there's some wisdom for you guys on there as well. We'll give you the address in just a moment. Getting hired, you can help us with that.
Well, when you think about it, we've so many changes in our industries, in our country. We've got globalization, mm-hmm. we've got technology changing, buyouts, downsizing, upsizing. There's so many changes in our job market. Mm-hmm. We really need to be our best when we finally do get an interview.
Mm-hmm. With that in mind, Terry, tip number one, when I'm trying to present myself to you, should I try to look at the big picture here, or do I need to deal with more specifics instead of generalities?
Well, we want to start with being prepared.
Okay.
Oftentimes in an interview, you don't know what type of interview process this particular interviewer has. We always assume that they're doing the best, when in fact, there's so many different kinds. So you want to be prepared for the best presentation for yourself. And the analogy that Dr. Green uses in his book, Get Hired, mm-hmm. is pretend that you're the seller and they're the buyer.
Okay.
Or for a baseball, I'm the batter and you're mm-hmm. the pitcher as the interviewer. So you want to be so prepared that you understand the different ways that these people can or cannot interview you, so you do your best.
How do you, so that you can quickly, once you sit down with them, identify this person is analytical, this person is?
Behavioral style, there's also interview styles.
Oh my gosh.
And we have to think about the generational overlay. If a 60s Civic is interviewing somebody who is maybe a Gen X, mm-hmm. there can also be some other what we call personal theory kind of interviews.
So how do I get inside your head then?
I want to figure out, I'm going to be the best that I can be.
Okay.
I want to be honest, I want to be concise, and I want to present the real picture. So to answer your question about being specific, you want to say what you can do and then what you're able to. So for instance, I can write copy, so I'm able to put together the copy for our meetings by tomorrow.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I see.
So you do that can do plus able to plus the benefit to you as the company equals real powerful phrasing, as opposed to I can do that.
So I can write copy on a deadline. I've done that for X number of years, and so for you,
your company,
I can.
Right.
Oh,
so,
I like that.
So that's number one. Be prepared and use those benefit statements. Number two, be specific. There was a time when our copywriter was ill. I had to come in at midnight. I was able to write this all out, and we were able to put the show on the next day.
Okay. Site-specific examples.
What about my brand, really knowing what my label is, so to speak?
Well, now that's real interesting because, again, the generational overlay is there. You want to dress slightly better than you would normally. Again, it depends on the position. Right? I mean, if you're going in for a dishwasher, wearing a three-piece suit might not work. But but seriously, what is your brand? And there's so many barriers. Think about it. Too much perfume, mm-hmm. jangly perfume, too much skin, especially for women, we talk about that.
Mm-hmm.
How can you present yourself in a way that resonates with what the company wants and what you're willing to do? Because let's face it, you're going to do a job well that you enjoy doing.
Mm-hmm.
Should you, on the issue of something as simple as perfume or jewelry, should you just not...
Well,
do not bring your personal style into it. For instance, look at these earrings, okay? Too dangly, probably, for any interview.
You know, and not necessarily. Here's the thing you have to realize. What if that person's allergic to perfume?
Mm-hmm.
That could, I mean, you could be wonderful for that job.
Right.
And aftershave is the same.
So you know, just
same.
Do without.
So just, I would say, be very subtle about
okay.
that. I mean, you're not going to want to diminish who you are, but they want to know what you can do for them.
Right.
Much more important than who you are.
They don't want anything to distract.
Which,
okay.
right.
What about personality, Terry? Because a lot of folks are just going to naturally assume, I'm going to walk in there, I'm going to really just turn it up, I'm going to show this great personality that I have, I'm going to win Terry over. Is that enough?
Well, you
especially
could do,
in my case.
You could do that. Well, Dr. Green particularly points out that self-grandizing doesn't really work. Remember, the company's looking for what's the best for the company.
Right.
The fact that you have a good personality is probably nice, but again, give them the benefits.
Right.
What's the benefit? If you work with me, I've worked with difficult people before, my personality is such that I enjoy diffusing those situations, and I've done it at such and such and such and such. So I think that would be a good value to your company mm-hmm. as opposed to I'm really good at it.
But you have to throw a little personality in there, don't you? Because clearly, even if you're not directly in customer service, for instance, working with the public, don't you have to have a little bit of...
Well, remember that people will always deal with you as a person.
Mm-hmm.
I think the challenge is the people that are, for instance, looking for jobs that don't require or do require personality, what's too much or too little, and the interviewer is the one that's making that decision.
Right.
So you're going to be yourself, but on it being honest, one of the points are those killer questions.
Right, right.
And for instance, with the internet and Facebook and LinkedIn and all the ways for people to do searches around you, mm-hmm. you have to deal with those killer questions. In some cases, they might be illegitimate.
Such
questions.
As?
For instance, are you going to be able to work after that baby is born?
Is that just a...
Well, it's not appropriate.
Illegal?
Yeah, it's just a not appropriate question.
Okay.
Would they...
How do you handle it?
Would you ask, would you ask a man, are you going to be able to work now that you have 12 children? You can't do that.
But how do you handle that if the interviewer
thing is you obviously recognize it, okay? The second thing you want to do is talk about go right to a strength. Yes, we do have children, and I've obviously had children for several years. We have, we have work in place that'll take care of that. One of the things that I'm really able to do is focus when I'm at work, so I'm not worried about my children. So you go to a strength, and you admit certainly that you're not perfect. Yes, I've had this bankruptcy mm-hmm. in my past before. There were situations. I've learned from them, and I'm moving on. And he has a whole chapter on that.
Great
Get the
tips
whole
there.
Enchilada.
That a lot of folks are going to need these days.
.com.
That's for sure.
Terry, thank you so much.
Terry, always glad to have you back.
Thank you.
Okay.
Up next, Making Music Ensemble.
It's next, right here on Live.